So welcome to Power to Speak, the podcast. And my guest today is Joanna Hooper. So welcome, Joanna.
Hello.
Hello, hello. Joanna, you run Limitless Peak Performance and you are a small business leadership coach. Is that the correct way of introducing you?
It is, although you didn't make nearly enough of a mock of the length of my business name than you should have done. So Limitless Peak Performance, nice idea, very hard to say in shorthand.
Yeah, and I did have trouble putting it on my board, I have to
say. No.
I mean, what I should have done was just left off the www.
But yes.
Yeah. But yeah, Limitless Peak Performance. I mean, that is quite a mouthful. Why the name? Tell us a little bit about what the name means to you and the business.
Well, this is definitely one of those cases where I did a lot of thinking about my business name and what it means to me, but not necessarily how it would work in practice, giving out as in an email address, for example. And this will come apparent in my story. I'm a huge believer that we are never the finished article, that our opportunities for development are indeed limitless, and that we all have our own versions of peak performance, and that, you know, therefore that stops us having to try and compare ourselves to other people's peak performance. So the idea being that my business would be all about kind of realizing that potential in people to reach their version of an unlimited kind of peak performance, basically.
And how did you come to that conclusion?
Partly from my own story, to be honest with you. So, if you'd have said to me back at the age of 18, I'd end up doing what I would be doing now, I'm not sure I'd have believed you. There's quite a lot of personal growth and development that's gone along that way. I'm not sure I'm all that recognizable in some respects for my 18-year-old self. So partly, you know, kind of mirroring my own experiences, but also recognizing in other people, particularly as a coach, you know, seeing transformations in people that even they couldn't have predicted, let alone you. You know, that's kind of the stuff where it comes from, really.
Yeah, no, and I absolutely agree with that. And I don't think any of us at this, at my ripe old age anyway, would recognize ourselves as, you know, the 18-year-old that we were. Yeah. I was wearing strange clothes and I was doing a fashion course. So yeah, completely, completely different. But it's, you are now doing something completely different, as you said.
Yes.
Because you spent 23 years in the Navy.
I did. I can't quite believe it now when you say it like that. But yes, yeah. I did.
So how did you end up in the Navy?
Honestly, two crappy A levels. When I was at school, it was a boarding school because my father was in the Navy as well. And unless you did pretty well at A levels, the further education wasn't really a thing. It wasn't really an opportunity for you. So I got two D's at A level because I kind of stopped finding the school environment kind of helpful or conducive to my learning. So I kind of, you know, drummed my fingers a bit, went, what on earth am I going to do now? And because my father had been in the Navy, I thought, well, I'll give it a go. Even when I joined up at the age of 18, I was thinking I'll give it a go for a bit. You know, I didn't expect to spend 23 years there. I couldn't have predicted anything like that. The good thing about the Navy is that it helped me, you know, improve my educational qualifications. So now I've got two masters, you know, Talk about the sublime to the ridiculous. But it got me to grow quite a lot in quite a lot of different ways. And I think because each of my jobs every 2 years was different and stretching and all that kind of stuff, it didn't feel like 23 years.
Yeah. I mean, and so did you travel? That probably sounds like a really
just
silly
a bit. I think the only places I haven't been are communist countries for the obvious reasons. You know, the Middle East, the Far East, Europe, America, but also for me personally, the Antarctic, which was one of the highlights of my career down in South America, South Africa and the Antarctic.
Wow. And you need a certain amount of resilience to live in that environment, even, do you think?
This
is completely alien to me, but I would imagine that when you go into something like the Royal Navy, you are very much dictated to by, you know, your whole kind of living experience is dictated by the job. Is that right?
It is. I suppose the bit for resilience for me is not necessarily the can you put up with being told what to do 24/7. For me, it's actually, you know, we're talking about an armed force. They are the delivery, you know, deliverers of violence, for want of a better reason. So the nature of the environment is not soft and fluffy. And one of the things I've really noticed since leaving the Navy is how sharp the banter was, you know, how kind of edgy all the banter was. So now that I've been out of the Navy for whatever it is, 6 or 7 years, I've noticed that I'm no longer the first one to come up with the joke or the banter that kind of gently chide somebody on something that they're doing or saying or feeling or something like that. So it's quite a, you know, it's a relatively harsh environment. We have to do harsh things. I joined up with the girls, you know, when the girls were first going to sea back in 1992. So that had its challenges as well. So no, it's definitely not an environment for which, I don't know, you can kind of wander through without a certain level of strength and resilience, I think.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I would imagine that you need quite a thick skin to,
yes,
to sort of be part of that environment and humour, I would say.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Definitely a good coping strategy.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, let's talk a little bit about your TED talk.
Yeah.
Because I don't know if anybody out there has actually seen it. And if not, I highly recommend going and checking out Joanna's TED talk. I have an image here. Let me find the image. Because apart from anything else, I think you need to be quite brave to stand on a TED stage on that little red spot and deliver something for 20 minutes that engages your audience. But obviously what you have is an amazing story to tell. So obviously the talk itself was really around your business and resilience and the work, yeah, you do with leaders.
Yes.
But actually it was your story or specifically a story within your career that,
yes,
you used to then teach the people in the audience.
Yes. So for those of you who haven't seen it yet, I was once on a ship. It was a naval warship. It was down in the Magellan Straits off the coast of off the bottom of South America. And really long story short, we started to sink and were in danger of capsizing. You know, to do justice to the topic in a couple of seconds is very tricky, but we were within 12 minutes of needing to evacuating the ship. You know, we thought the ship was going. And unsurprisingly, that was quite a stressful kind of event. And it strikes me there's quite a lot of rich learning that comes out of those sinking ship stories in our lives. And I wonder sometimes whether or not we pay attention to them or they just become a good Lord, don't ever want to repeat that again. And what I've tried to do, both with the TED talk and actually some of the other talks I do, is bring to life the learning journey that I've been on. So that happened, that sinking ship story is from 2008. So we're talking quite a long time of reflective practice for me, for want of a better word, of looking back and going, okay, so, you know, what was going on for me in that moment? What was going on for me after that moment? What have I learned about myself since then? What do I put into my day-to-day practice? What do I help other people put into day-to-day practice? You know, I use that sinking ship story for a bunch of very rich learning, both about myself and about other people. And the key premise that I come up with is you know, in a kind of trademarked way, a stress deserves diagnosis. I think there's a whole bunch of us looking for resilience building practices and clutching at straws, for want of a better word, of the things that we can do. So this week I'm going to try mindfulness, next week it's yoga, the week after that is meditation. We have no idea what we're doing it for, we have no idea what we're trying to fix with it, and we have no idea whether it's going to work for us. So we try it for a bit, it doesn't work, we put it down again, and we haven't gone through that diagnostic practice of saying, well, what is it that I need, and therefore is this the right thing for me to take on? And that's what I basically, in my TED talk, I tried to kind of, you know, obviously tell the story, which is quite impactful, but then also encourage people to do that kind of analysis of why they're stressed, what's stressing them out, and what they can do about it.
Yeah. I mean, and what really struck me after what happened with the ship and that process that you went through on board, that afterwards you had so many physical ailments.
Yeah.
That were kind of related to that. You know, it's post-traumatic stress, isn't it, really?
And, I guess it is.
It comes, yeah, out physically. So yes. How did you deal with that?
Well, I think at the time I was, and it sounds a bit of a cliche, and I wonder how many of us would say this as well, I was so busy, I'm not sure I noticed. There was so much to do in the aftermath of the flood, and I was the logistics officer. So, you know, feeding people, you know, toilet facilities, getting people back to the UK, reclothing some people, giving them passports and visas because that stuff had all been sunk. You know, there's quite a lot to do, getting rid of all the rubbish on board ship. So I wasn't sure I was present enough to pay attention to what was going on to me. So in some of those stress symptoms that I talk about, I only really noticed that they were going on for me afterwards. And now I can see that it's like I've dialed up my noticing and now I see them. So now I notice if I'm chewing my fingers, for example, okay, what's going on for me? Whereas before, I just chewed my fingers. You know, I'd never made the correlation between my stress levels and me chewing my fingers.
Yeah. Yeah. And so is it, I mean, obviously you're talking about diagnostics, but is it just that practice of noticing?
There's a bit of that. And there's a framework that I provide through some of my coaching around mental toughness, which helps us understand what might be a stress trigger. So it's a four C's model: confidence, commitment, challenge, and control. And invariably one of those C's is playing the larger part of the stress. So, you know, in the flood, for example, clearly I was out of control. The C was very much in control. The challenge was high because we had a lot to do in a short period of time. You know, the commitment was definitely required. We couldn't give up. I couldn't go and sit in my cabin for a cup of tea. Do you know what I mean? That wasn't really the time. And confidence, particularly for me, because I wasn't sure I was up for the job. You know, I was meant to be the damage control officer, keeping the old girl afloat. And I wasn't sure I was up for it, to be honest with you. So, you know, in that instance, all four of my C's were, you know, pinging off like red lights. But for the rest of us, there'll be one of them which has more of a power for us. You know, maybe it's about confidence, maybe it's about the minute we start to get over challenged or over committed, then that's when it starts to trigger for us, or when we feel out of control. And what I do is I encourage people just to kind of rummage around in that as well. So it's not just noticing what stress symptoms we had. And I don't know if you remember from the TED talk that I kind of asked the audience, you know, how many of those were you ticking off as I spoke them? And the number of people were kind of going, actually, yes. And then the number of people going, I hadn't made that connection before. But then obviously getting under the skin of, well, why are you feeling this way? What's causing it for you?
Yeah. Do you think there's part of your, of what you went through that has made you good at the job that you do now? Or was it something maybe that you learned from being part of the Navy that makes you good at what you're doing now?
I don't know. Possibly, to be honest with you. I think the two things that I really remember that I definitely use in my current practice, bearing in mind that, you know, I'm currently doing performance coaching, which is nothing like counting the bullets, blankets and beans on board a ship. The first one is using intelligence to create rapport. So getting to really know people. And particularly if I think about the stressful situations on board ship, one of the chaps who was meant to be one of my communication specialists started to get so stressed he couldn't speak to me very well. And so, you know, kind of knowing him the way that I did, you know, finding a way to get him to calm down so he could carry on speaking to me. And then the other thing is getting behind how people present. So often we see people behaving oddly or badly, and we take them on face value and don't get curious about why they're showing up that way. And what I do know, again, from the flood is people don't always show up the way that you expect when they're stressed, and kind of getting super curious about why that might be and what's going on for them, and therefore how you need to respond in order to get them to perform as best as they can be in some quite difficult circumstances. I think I've always had a natural curiosity for what's going on for people, and that's definitely helpful as a coach, I think.
I mean, I like the way that you say that when people are stressed, sometimes they show up differently to the way you expect them to.
Yes.
And, you know, as much as it's probably not very relevant, but when years and years ago, I was a dresser at the Royal Shakespeare Company.
Fabulous.
And it was amazing. We'd be in rehearsals and the actors that I was dressing would be lovely. I mean, just really, really nice. Come to press night, they were hellish, you know, and I learned from that's what stress can do for you.
Yes.
You know, that's what, if people are that nervous, the adrenaline is really pumping, then that will come out in different ways.
So I call them accidental monsters. So, you know, you take perfectly nice people, you dial up the pressure, and all of a sudden they behave in ways that actually they wouldn't be that proud of. And I know I've certainly been an accidental monster on, you know, a number of occasions. And it's just, as you say, the stress dials up and maybe you get more, a bit more terse. Maybe you get more a bit impatient. Maybe you get a bit directive, you know, ordinarily not the ways that you'd like to be. There's a lovely expression, isn't there? Under stress, we regress. So this idea that it doesn't matter how well we might wish to perform and be, ultimately you start to turn up that dial. and we won't be those things.
Yeah. So how do you deal with leaders that seem to not be able to cope with that stress, that are accidental monsters all the time?
Well, I think the first one is something a friend of mine calls the ugly mirror. Show them who are they when they're under pressure. Show them what's the impact. Show them the counterproductive effects of their leadership style. You know, the people who are hiding in the corners, the lies they're being told, the truths they're not being told, you know, the performance that's not taking place, the productivity that's vanishing because, you know, so the first one is an ugly mirror. And the second one is, for me, it's a bit, you know, back to that looking beyond. Sometimes, if you've heard the expression toxic yes. leadership can often come from underconfidence, I think. So if you can bolster the confidence, that toxic leadership tends to kind of evaporate. But it can be hard. You know, I've definitely coached people who I haven't always liked the way that they're showing up. You know, you've got to kind of play that back to them. Do you know that this is what you're doing? Do you know that this is the impact you're having?
Yeah. Yeah. I was just looking down because we were talking before we started recording. And you said that coaching is not a luxury.
Not a luxury.
No. And I found that as well with what I do, which a lot of what I do, as much as it is around sort of public speaking and standing on a stage, you know, maybe doing a TED talk, it really is about boosting people's confidence, yeah. but just giving them permission and telling them, actually, you can do this. There's no reason necessarily for them not to enjoy sharing their ideas, not to enjoy, yeah. you know, running their business. You know, the stress is something they kind of bring on themselves. And sometimes yeah. when you just give them that permission. So I absolutely agree. I think coaching is something everybody should go through because sometimes you just need that ugly mirror.
Yes.
Sometimes you just need somebody to show you.
Yes,
you know how you react in certain situations for you, yeah. because otherwise you can't, you know, you can't
do anything about it.
No,
yeah. yeah, I think it's not just the ugly mirror. I think it's a cheerleader as well. So I've had some confidence crises throughout my life, and I do think there's a correlation between how I've shown up sometimes and a result of that confidence crisis. And if only I'd had a little cheerleader in the corner or somebody with an ugly mirror. Gosh, what could my performance have been like if only I'd had that support? You know what I mean? So that for me is definitely something that I want to help people who aren't seeing the results they'd like, performing in a way that they'd like, getting the results from other people that they'd like, is just spend an hour. You know, yeah. let's see what's going on for you. And I do think there's a part of us, you know, I can never remember, is it Jahari's window? There's a bit of us we don't even know ourselves. There's a dark spot of us we're blind to. Yeah. And sometimes we need somebody else's, you know, eyes to see that before we yeah. can have a go at it.
Yeah. I mean, I say, you know, our stories are our unique selling point. Mm. And, you know, there's something in all of us that we've either been through, whether it's something quite traumatic that has kind of shaped the way we've got to this point. And as you say, people deal with it differently. Some people will go through a traumatic experience like you did on that ship, and it will, they'll use that fear going forward and yes. they'll keep that stress with them.
Yes.
And other people will see it as a learning.
Yes.
Something to learn from, and they will take it, and it will build empathy that then they will have when other people are going through stressful yeah. situations.
Yes.
So is that something you see within what you do?
Yeah, very much so. So when I do this, when I do some of the TED Talk stuff in person, I talk a lot about stress and resilience and so on, and I tell the sinking ship story a fair bit. Invariably, at the end of the speech, as I'm leaving, there's somebody runs up to me afterwards to tell me their version of the sinking ship story. And yeah. I've heard some, you know, horror stories in relation to the sinking ship. Don't get me wrong, that wasn't an awful lot of fun. But this idea that there's something about my story that connects with other people and helps them share their story and helps them see their story perhaps in a light that they hadn't seen it before, and as a tool for development rather than just this horror anchor, if you like.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that tool for development. I think that's a really, really good way of putting it, because I think we can use those. And if nothing else, sharing your story can validate somebody else's story. So it's not about you when you stand up there and share your story. It's about the audience. You know, you're not the hero of that talk. It's the audience, and that, you know, they need to they'll find something in your story that will validate theirs.
One of the things I always try and do in my coaching or tutoring or wherever it is that I'm doing is what I call normalization. And it's something to do with what, you know, both the kind of the myth and the power of leadership. I think some of us put leadership on a bit of a pedestal. It's something that other people do really well. It's the Gandhis. It's not little old folks like us. And then by extension, getting leadership wrong is something that only really bad people do. I've got leadership wrong so many times, I've lost count. And I try and normalize both the fact that none of us are perfect products, none of us are finished products. Even the best leaders will carry on learning and developing. And actually, all of us in our lives have probably been accidental monsters or bad leaders in some way. So a lot of my storytelling is not just kind of sharing you know, stories like the sinking ship, but stories where I've got leadership catastrophically wrong. And I'm very happy to share, yeah, don't do it that way. You know, if anyone can learn vicariously from not doing it the way I've done it, you know, I'm all for sharing that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So what did you want to be when you grew up?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not really sure, if I'm honest with you. Actually, that's utter nonsense. I do know. I just don't think I ever wanted to admit it when I was younger.
Oh, go on, tell me.
I wanted to be an actress.
So did I. Do you know though, Joanna, I knew that about you because you could just tell by the way that you perform for that TED Talk that, you know, there is something of the performer in you that is quite natural. Mm. So yeah, tell me a little bit more about that. Why did you not go down that route?
So again, it comes back to the confidence thing. So when I was at school, because I was at a boarding school, they used to call it elocution lessons, or as we used to call it, electrocution lessons. But actually, it was all about speech and drama. And I did some speech and drama exams when I was at school. And at the time, I was really fascinated with taking that further and doing it professionally. But honestly, I didn't think I was any good. I had zero confidence about it. And many years later, apparently my art or my drama teacher said to my mother, she's brilliant. She'll be fabulous on television. She's got perfect, you know, expressive face for television. Well, if only she could have told me that in the moment, that would have been quite helpful. But my mother telling me some years later, by which time I'd already joined the Navy and kind of disposed of my dreams of becoming an actress. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't all that helpful. I honestly had no confidence in myself. I thought I was rubbish.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, I do have a similar story, actually, because when I was 16, I went to my careers teacher and said I wanted to be an actress. And she almost laughed in my face, to be fair. and actually, I thought I was quite good. I knew I was quite good. And my mum was sat beside me going, oh, she's very good. She's very good. But the careers officer just sort of shook her head and went, no, what else can you do? And I said, well, I'm not bad at art. And that was it. I was off to, not that, you know, I loved art, that was fine, but it was just the fact that if she didn't believe me, this careers teacher, who else, you know, nobody was going to believe me. So I just dropped it, and I didn't come back to it until I was in my sort of mid to late 20s, really. And that's when I went to drama school.
Well, I think mine's even later than that. So I did these exams and stuff when I was, what, 16, 17, 18, and then I joined the Navy, and there was no place for all of that, thank you, except in the sods operas, do you know what I mean? So actually, I didn't come back round to it until the TED Talk, and it was the TED Talk that really almost like took me full circle back to that performing, as you said, you know. Yeah. I don't know if you remember your exams where, you know, you'd walk into the room with a, you know, adjudicator sat at the far end behind a table, shake their hand, hello, my name's Joanna, I'm going to do a piece from Ring of Bright Water, and then go back to the other side of the room and get straight into it, you know. And for me, the TED Talk was a bit like that. The minute you stepped on the red dot, you were in performance mode. Yeah. And kind of that being able to kind of flick it straight on, go from normal to performing in a moment, that took me right back there, to be honest with you. Yeah. And that was somewhat older than 20s.
Well, no, I mean, obviously, we were talking before we started recording that you have a gold medal, a Lambda gold medal in speaking
voice and
growth, which I also have as well. And I'm very, very proud of. So now that you've done the TED Talk, was that the first sort of public speaking thing that you had done since the Navy? And do you think being an officer in the Navy helped you with that performance? Do you think it sort of shaped you a little bit more as a performer?
That's a really interesting one. So I had done standing up in front of other people and talking. I'd done a couple of, if you like, professional gigs. So I had a couple of speaking gigs for a think tank called RUSI, talking about, you know, workforce futures for the armed forces. And I had a guest appearance at Cranfield University on one of their major leadership programs, where I would talk about the sinking ship and resilience and stuff. But I'd never done any what I would call proper speaking gigs, if you like. So TEDx was my first one. And I remember talking to somebody who was a professional speaker who poo-pooed TEDx as being, you know, sort of a bit, oh, well, you know, go off and do that if you like, but it's not really, nobody takes that seriously. But for me, that was the first step into the ladder of professional speaking. And the military equipping me, yes or no. So I think there are some things it really helped with: posture, poise, understanding how you move and fidget when you're talking. Great. What I found less helpful, it almost made me a robot, and I had to kind of deconstruct that. So from the TED talk, I really experimented with fluidity and of movement. So particularly when I'm talking about stepping ashore into life rafts, and I kind of do that sort of slight jaunt. That didn't come from the Navy. That was definitely more of the performer in me than the naval briefer, if you like. So in some respects, I found that the naval experience hindered me a bit, because it made me a bit stiff and a bit too formal, and I had to kind of loosen up again and, you know, kind of shake that off a bit, you know, but kind of not throwing away everything. So understanding about what you're doing with your hands, you know, if you're doing too much of this business, you know, that was kind of helpful.
Yeah. Did you have any coaching on that?
Yes. A lovely lady called Adrienne Saunders. I don't know if you've come across her.
I'm very aware of Adrienne.
So she was our pro bono professional speaking coach for the TEDx, and she gave me two really great bits of advice. The first one was lean into the story. So that was part of that kind of almost embodying the story. Do you see, I just did that with the shoulders went then. And the second one was using my humor. She said to me, I had a really nice, safe sense of humor, and I could use that, you know, really kind of really lean into that as well. And again, that was something that I was experimenting with it to some respects with the TED talk, you know, using that sense of humor and liking it, if I'm honest with you.
Absolutely. I think it really made you very relatable, actually, that, you know, the humor was something that I don't think you can be as engaging as, you know, as you possibly can be without humor. I think, you know, because it's that connection with the audience. It kind of really, it's an emotional, it's a gut reaction. And an audience will remember that. So if you can, you can sort of find something that's going to emotionally connect with your audience, whether it's, I mean, there are other things apart from humor, but humor is quite universal. So,
I really liked it, actually. The first time I used it, the first time I talked about the ship flooding, was actually to a bunch of other naval logistics officers. And it was the same sort of length as the TED talk. And I remember talking about fear, and I felt like fear was a bit of a taboo topic, because as military officers, you know, fear is one of those, no, you don't want to feel that, you just want to get on with it. And I used humor to break the atmosphere after talking about fear. And that was the first time I'd really experimented with the power of humor and how you can use it as for transitions between something serious to something else, or, you know, a transition from one topic to the next or something like that, as well as a way of expressing my own sort of sense of personality and take on the world.
I do wonder, just sort of talking about the formality of the Navy, and I mean, because as you were talking there and you were saying it made you quite robotic, I can imagine that not just the formality of being in the Navy, but the formality and the what's the word I'm looking for? The fact that it's very male dominated, is that it, did you find that there was almost like an extra layer of perfectionism that you had to have to kind of rise above the fact that you were talking to, you know, a room full of men?
I think there were certain things that were taken out of context. So expressing feelings, I think, wouldn't have been seen as expressing feelings. It would have been seen as some sort of weakness or fluffiness or sentimentality or something like that. There's a word that we used to kick around, you know, one must have gravitas. And even that word feels quite male in the way that you describe it. And what does that even mean anyway? So, yes, I did feel like, I don't know if you've heard this expression before about aping, you know, when you become like the others in order to fit in. And I did feel like I'm more authentic Joanna now than perhaps I would have been then as a result of that.
Yeah, I mean, that sort of came across when you were talking about the humour and the fact that, you know, that you've now been able to kind of interject that, it put that humour into what it is that you're speaking about.
Yeah.
I mean, I find when I'm coaching, especially in sort of corporate situations, if I'm in a room with leaders, that they have a persona that they feel they have to live up to.
Yes.
You know, they have to be very formal, they have to speak in a certain way, use a certain language, which
yes.
is fair enough, you know, it's that's their profession, they kind of need that. But what I love to do is to just you know, get them running around the room and pretending to be someone else and throwing it all up in the air and getting them to play, because I think, like you were talking about, you know, you when you're in that situation of introducing humor and movement and that sort of performance stuff, I think you almost, and certainly in my drama classes, you're kind of almost taken on another character. So you have to get rid of all of the stuff that you've learned that has kind of
yes.
bound you up into this sort of little ball over the years, and just loosen it all off. Actually, you did that too, is that kind yes. of shake it all off and almost start again. It's like, okay, yes. well, I can, you know, I'm not going to be any less professional by being more relatable, by yes. showing some vulnerability, by telling you my story, by sharing a joke. You know, that still makes you relatable, whether you're talking to a room full of your employees or whether you're talking to investors, or, you know, it doesn't matter what level you're talking on, you need that kind of relatability.
You do. And I suppose there's two observations I notice. The first one is, I've certainly given, I talk now in my speeches a bit more kind of colloquial, I guess, than I might yeah. have done. And I've definitely had feedback, you know, if she says the word kinder one more time, I'm going to smash her in the face, you know. So there are, unfortunately, still folks out there for whom this more relaxed delivery style doesn't work. And the second thing is, knowing that there are folks out there that don't like it, it then gets in your head and you then find yourself adopting a level of formality because your confidence starts to get, well, certainly when I say one, you know, this is one's confidence starts to get jarred, and then you start to go, I must formalize myself again. So yeah. for me, there's always a constant battle between who I want to be and having the confidence to be that person, and kind of saying, okay, so for every person that goes, oh, I don't like her delivery, cool, you know,
yeah,
hopefully there'll
yeah.
be a couple of folks who do.
Yeah, well, this is, you know, it's finding your voice that then relates to other people that you want to kind of be those are the people that you want to work with.
Yes.
So, I mean, I don't know. Obviously, we all want to work, so we don't want to turn people away. But I kind of feel that if people don't like my delivery, then maybe they're not the person I want to work with. But obviously, you know, people have their professions and they're, you know, they need to stay professional. So I suppose there is a little bit of keeping hold of that formality if you really need to.
Yes, I guess it's about being clear when it's appropriate and when it's, you know, you've got the freedom to step out from behind it.
Yeah, yeah. So what is a hybrid hero?
So I don't know about you, but my business doesn't look anything like it did a couple of years ago, where I was commuting 4 hours a day up to London and back several times a week. So I'm sort of combining my consulting, coaching, tutoring, public speaking expertise with my own experiences of pivoting my stuff online and doing huge amounts of personal development online, particularly in 2020 when it all went a bit quiet for me, certainly. And what I really noticed was how some people who were, you know, spent 20 years, say, for example, delivering in person, overnight doing it online, but with a fraction of the level of expertise and insight and experience and polishing that they've done for their face-to-face. And what I started to notice was a whole bunch of people who were really good at what they did, but because they didn't have that same level of polish for their online as in person, they were missing out in some way, or it wasn't quite going as well as they might like. So I actually had a session with a business coach who described online delivery, or helping other people do online delivery really well, as a bit of my zone of genius, which I hadn't necessarily attributed. But for some reason, it kind of clicks together all of my experiences and my and the things that I think I'm all right at. And it helps me help other business owners kind of really become a hybrid hero. I've got another course which is called Host Like a Hero, which is kind of similar, but that's all about how do you use the technology, how do you set up your fuss-free home studio, as I call it, how do you manage yourself in the moment, you know, before you go on stage, if you like. So there's a lot of acting analogy used in it, as you might imagine. And the hybrid hero is about, you know, what are you doing about your working environment to make sure your online is matching your face-to-face in terms of quality. So for example, I had a yoga teacher come on and do the course, and didn't want to wear a headset when they were performing, but naturally therefore their voice disappeared the minute they went into, you know, the standing dog or whatever it is over there. And we talked about, you know, what could you get on the ceiling in film of a multi-directional kind of microphone. So kind of just helping people really, really examine all the parts of their delivery online and figure out how they might then switch that up in terms of quality.
I mean, it's so needed, isn't it, at the moment? And certainly every Zoom room networking call that I've been on, and I've told people what it is that I do, it's like, oh my gosh, I need that. I need, you know, because suddenly, and it's not just about the transition from in person to online. I think it's also that kind of the fact that now people are, customers, clients expect to see you. They expect to hear you.
Yes,
it's we can't hide behind business cards anymore, really. People are having to learn a whole new thing.
Yes. Well, there's two things I'd say to that, actually. The first one is, I think our tolerance for DIY in the online space is evaporating. So because now online is becoming much more de rigueur, I'm not willing to see your pants in the background or the kids running back and forth. You know, I want it to feel and look as professional as it would if you were sat in a conference room or in a training room. I think that's the first one.
Yeah, I've tried to, I've changed my background for you today, actually.
I love it.
Because I suddenly sort of thought with the background I had before, it was kind of getting a bit cluttered. This is less cluttered, but it's, you know, it's not the same as having a studio.
No, and I think we don't all have the luxury to create our own little bespoke, you know, offices or corners of the lounge or whatever it might be. So we have to make do with what we've got. So I'm in my conservatory, which this morning was 3 degrees. Mm. You know, in the height of summer then turns into 40 degrees, which is not ideal. But I think just being really mindful about what it is that you're delivering. So I think definitely our expectations of cuffing it, as we used to say in the Navy, have definitely diminished. And actually, a lot more of us want to deliver this way anyway. So why not get it looking as professional as you're in person? You know, because then you're going to compete with the likes of, there's a friend of mine who's been doing online training for 10 years. And honestly, her setup looks like an air traffic control center, you know, so that's who you're competing with, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, and I've sort of discovered, or looking at different platforms other than Zoom to actually work with, you know, like with StreamYard, it's a little bit more interesting. So,
yes.
You know, and you can do meetings on this and you can have up to 10 people and all of those things. So I think it's worth, you know, now nobody had heard of Zoom 2 years ago. Nobody even knew what it was. Whereas now there are new platforms coming online all the time, different ways of doing presentations too. So I think it's worth people looking at different ways of doing stuff online.
Yes, and I'm certainly not an expert on the packages that you can use and things like that. Where I try and help people is just be more mindful about the thinking that they might do about whether or not what they're using is fit for purpose. You know, does it produce as quality a service as what they were doing in person? Is there something that needs to change? You know, that kind of stuff. That's where I kind of take people on their thinking journey, really.
Yeah. And in the resilience side of things, are you you're still running boot camps around resilience?
I am. So the way that it tends to work is obviously something like the TED Talk kind of plants the seed of the stress deserves diagnosis angle I take to dealing with stress and resilience. And the boot camps are an opportunity for you to get some help with that diagnostic, do it in real time, maybe use some other folks to kind of co-create or collaborate on the thinking. So we don't always have the best ideas just for ourselves. So each of the boot camps is an opportunity for you to, you know, collaborate and co-create your personalized resilience plan. So in the TED Talk, you will have heard me talk about, you know, if you go Googling top tips for resilience, you know, you get 49 million hits, flipping heck. So it's this idea that you get really specific on what you need to build your resilience, not what Janine from accounts needs or anyone else, quite frankly, but, you know, do some work on figuring out what you need. And the boot camps are an opportunity to do that, basically. Yeah.
So what is your top tip on building? Having said three top tips on building resilience, what would be your one thing that would kind of define what it is to be resilient? Because it is a word that seems to be used a lot, and I just wonder whether people actually really understand.
So that's really interesting. One of the things that I used to talk about with Cranfield University was, do we know what we mean by resilience? Do we think it's somehow impervious or unflappable? You know, do we think that when people who get the Victoria Cross, when they dart across battlefields, aren't feeling fear? Because I'm here to tell you, they flipping are. They've just managed to master it in some way. So certainly the key thing for me is, I used to say this, our resilience is forged through adversity, not despite it. So this idea that if we never test ourselves, we never grow. If we never put ourselves in difficult circumstances, we don't know what we're capable of. You know, if you'd have said to me, so here's the deal, Joanna, you're going to stay awake for the best part of 3 days, you're going to need to make some life-changing decisions about keeping the ship afloat, and you're going to need to do that while quite tired, probably haven't eaten for 12 hours, and the ship's going to be rolling really badly and in danger of capsizing, cool, I'd have gone, ooh, no, that's not me. And you don't know what you're capable of until you give something a go. So definitely this sense that resilience is forged through adversity, not by avoiding it, I think.
Absolutely agree with that. Yeah. So how can people get in touch with you? So how can they find out about the coaching that you do and how they can work with you? I've got your website here. Is that the best place for people?
Yes. On my website is a lovely little contact us section, I think. You can book direct with me, actually. I think on my website, because I use a diary booking system, you can book a free consultation with me. So you always get half an hour to an hour on me with me. And we can kick around whatever you like, quite frankly. There's a couple of my free little events, like the Hybrid Hero, and the Resilience Bootcamps are paid events, but nonetheless, they're quite affordable, I think. You can drop me an email, which is basically my first name at my god-awful long business name, .co.uk. Or you can find me on LinkedIn. I'm on there quite a bit as well. Oh, yeah. Yeah. As if by magic.
You do like long...
I know. I don't know what that is about. I need to see if anyone's got the domain name LPP and just shorten it to that, I think, don't I?
Yes. Yeah, that might be a way to go. Fabulous. Oh, well, thank you very much for your time today. It's been lovely to talk to you. I feel like I've found somebody that talks my language.
A fellow Lambda.
A fellow Lambda, yeah. I also hear that you have a motorcycle license. So how often do you get out on a bike?
Not so much now. I used to quite a bit. I used to kid myself that I looked like Trinity from The Matrix because I rode a black ninja. But not for a while now. And I've always been rubbish with the cold and the wet, quite frankly. That's never fun on a motorbike. Unfortunately, my current partner used to work with the ambulance service and has regrettably seen too many motorcyclists come off the wrong side of a discussion with a car or a lorry. So he's not a massive fan. So probably not for a while now. But yes.
No. But it wasn't something you had to do for the Navy. It wasn't something.
No. It was purely for fun.
Yeah. They've always frightened the life out of me. So, yeah.
Me too. But do you know what? Going back to the old resilience is forged through adversity, that may be why I liked it, because at all times you are sort of on the edge of your comfort zone and what you think you can do versus what the bike can do and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, maybe that's why I liked it.
Yeah. And have you got any talking engagements coming up? Any speaking?
I have got a couple. So this week I'm talking to something called the ARNO, the Association of Royal Naval Officers, all about stress and resilience, and they do like a story of a sinking ship. The week after that, the lovely Adrienne Saunders is part of something called Wine, Women and Wisdom. I think that's the 26th that we're speaking. I've got a session on that one as well. That's in the evening. I've got an inquiry tomorrow. People who want to talk about air safety want to use my sinking ship story. I think because all the lessons are the same, but the story's like so far out of whack compared to air safety, kind of lands quite well.
I should hope so with air safety.
Indeed. I think that's all I can think of at the moment. But yeah, a few things coming up.
Brilliant. Well, have a fabulous 2022. Sounds very exciting.
Thank you. And yeah. You.
And I would absolutely recommend listening to Joanna's TEDx talk. It's TEDx Southampton.
It is. If you go on the TED.com website and look me up, I think I'm the only one there. So I should be dead easy to find.
Yeah. I will put all these links for those of you that are listening to the audio of this podcast. I will put all the links in the show notes. But otherwise, you can find us on YouTube and watch us. Watch me play with StreamYard, which is great fun. Thank you very much, Joanna. And enjoy the rest of your week. And thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been lovely to speak to you.